Yo, what is going on, people? Welcome to Throw Down Your Questions, episode 434. I'm your host, Tony Polanco, and tonight I'm joined by Emilio Lopez.
What's up, people? How's it going?
Carlos Romero.
Yo, yo, yo.
Brett Murdoch.
What up?
And Brian Majoma.
Did you guys actually talk if we got those numbers right, those 8.4 millions?
No, we actually didn't discuss that. But if anybody wants to ask about that, wink, wink, feel free to. You know, those numbers are very interesting. Very lopsided, if you know what I mean, Brian. Because it was like 32 million total, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so that kind of lets you know something. Anyway, a couple of things. So no Adam action tonight. I think he has family over. Chris will probably join us later. He's like packing to go to Florida. And speaking about Florida, if Manny sounds different to you, it's because he is in Florida right now.
Yep. I am visiting family out here. It's been a long time coming. And I'm also going to, tomorrow's my birthday, the 15th. So I'm going to be going to Disney World.
Hey, you know, happy birthday, man.
Like the cliche, right? Thank you.
Good stuff. Yeah, I'm going to Disney World.
Yep. Manny, you survived another year without tragic death. What are you going to do?
I'm going to Disney World.
I'm going to Disney World.
Yeah. And obviously, you know, Manny's, you know, he can't be raising his voice. So just, you know, we'll forgive him.
Sorry about that. I can get too heated. I don't want to disturb my dad or mom, my stepmom. So.
But Manny, there's a balance, though. We you know, you can't raise your voice, but there's no wind tunnel, so you sound very clear.
Yes, that's my girlfriend's setup over there. It involves a lot of air purification, so you'll get like a little bit of wind if you hear it in our podcast. But yeah, it's very.
I feel like we're getting AM radio, Manny.
Yeah, I wonder how many people know about AM radio. You know. Real quick story before we start. So, you know, Mother's Day and all that, went to visit my mom. My sister was there with the kids. And Manny, I was going through Instagram and stuff, and I saw your, you know, your Walkman, right, with the cassette. And I was like, hey, let me try something. So I showed the picture to my niece and nephew. I'm like, do you guys know what this is? And they looked at it. It's like, that's for music, right? I'm like, okay, you got that part right. That's good. But do you know the names of these things? So I point to the cassette. Like, what is that? They're like, okay. I'm like, that's a cassette. And one of them kind of goes, oh, okay. And I'm like, this? That's a Walkman. You put cassettes inside and you listen to music. And they were like, wow. Like, they were like blown away. You know, it's crazy. Bro,
you should have told the tape was called an MP2.
Yeah, I'm trying to give them actual information. I fuck with them.
I mean, you know? Like, you know, the thing about it is, like, you know, there would be somewhat familiar because Star-Lord uses that in the Guardians of the Galaxy.
What if they've never seen Starting Again? Yeah, well, they probably never seen that movie, you know?
Well, I mean, first Guardians came out in 2014.
Yeah.
So they had to have been at least old enough to see that, right?
Yeah, they would have because they're both 11 now. But again, they're not really MCU kids, you know?
Okay, makes sense.
So yeah, that was pretty interesting.
I don't think most kids are MCU kids. I think that's a problem MCU's having.
Yeah, you know, among other things, right? Anyway, we got a lot of questions. This is probably going to be a spicy episode, people, so get ready for that. It's going to be crazy. By the way, many people in the chat are wishing you a happy birthday, so that's cool.
Oh, thank you. This has been a long time coming. This was actually, I wanted to do this when we turned 40 in 2020. Me and Tony went out to New Orleans for his birthday. And then literally the next month, March, the world just turned to shit.
Yep.
And I couldn't do anything. My birthday's in May, so I was in the middle of pandemic time. And you know, I don't talk too much about it, but some really crazy stuff happened to me at that point in time. So
yeah,
there's a lot of stress in that time.
Yeah, you've discussed it on the show, obviously.
So it was a lot of stress at that time, and it just, you know, sort of a long time coming. So happy belated 40th birthday to myself.
Yes. And joining us right in time, right before we get to the first question, Mr. Chris, who's going to be going to Florida soon.
Hey, what's up?
So, yeah, Manny was telling me you guys are kind of going to be missing each other. Manny, how's that going to work?
Yeah, so Chris is leaving tomorrow, which is on my birthday. And then I'm leaving the following day on the 16th. So we're just just ships passing each other.
Yes. Crazy. All right, man, let's get into it. First question here. Dumeke. I wanted to start off with this question. And this is a topic we've discussed and debated about many times, but so we'll try not to go too crazy, but I'm just going to let it go where it's going to go. But it is pertinent to what's going on now. Question, should numbered reviews go away? Oh, boy. So he gets into it. When some people see a 10 out of 10 for a game, it seems to really trigger them. If they don't like a game or for whatever reason, why do they care so much? It's all just someone's opinion in the end. Interested in your thoughts, given there are past and present reviewers on Throwdown. Separate question, but along the same lines, there have been plenty of times where people have rightfully had a go at fans for attacking sites that give a low score. Again, who the fuck cares? But where is the same energy for non-fans attacking sites for giving a high score? All right, so let's tackle both of those. Again, my views on review scores have been consistent since the beginning, 11 years now. I am a person that has to put review scores on my reviews. I hate review scores. They undermine everything I do. It's like I write this whole thing. People just skip, go to that. Perfect example of this. When I was writing for Duke Shotters in 2014, I reviewed Infamous Second Son, right? I gave it a 95 out of 100. That's pretty high. Also, that's what fans, you know, Tony fans call a Tony perfect. Because I'm like, if a game is 10 out of 10, that's perfect. It has to, you cannot have any fuck up. So 95 is a Tony perfect because I will never give a game a 10 out of 10, not 100. Anyway, so I wrote this pretty good review and I'm looking at the comments and stuff. This is back in the day when I actually still looked at comments. And one of them was, why'd you give it a 95? I'm like, did you not read the review? I explained myself. Right, and then he goes, I'm not trying to read all that. Just give me the summary. I'm like, you fucking piece of shit. I didn't say that, but it was like, okay, this is.
If you weren't trying to read all that, then why did he ask you to expand on it?
Yeah, I know.
I want to read all this, but I don't want to read what you wrote. I want you to write another thing so I can read that.
Yeah, he wanted me just to do a condensed version. I'm like, there's little pros and cons if you don't want to read. What? Like, so yeah, and by the way, this is also not a Tony thing. Most of my peers, other reviewers, also do not like review scores. But obviously, the companies we work for, they like review scores, you know. So it is what it is. So again, I'm not trying to debate the point here. My stance has never changed on this. I don't like review scores, but I also agree that people shouldn't get pissy over review scores. I think it was Killzone 2, right? On X-Play, they gave the game like a 9 out of 10, something, or 4.5, whatever the fuck it was, right? Their review. People got pissed off because they gave the game a high score. It's like, wait, what? Like, it's just so silly. I mean, to me, review scores, they mostly just fuel fanboy shit at the end of the day, especially with fucking Metacritic and stuff. I can't stand that site. You know, but yeah, again, I'm not trying to belabor a point. I've talked about this for over a decade already. My feelings are well known about this, so yeah, I think they're bullshit.
I'm actually reading on chat, so I can hear you guys hating on me tonight. And Blitz actually brings up a good point that I did want to kind of bring up. Y'all know I'm on the other side of the fence from Tony. I like review scores. I don't think that there's a problem with them, and I think Blitz brings up a good reason why. I don't think a 10 is a perfect score. A 10 is just the best you can reasonably expect. There's no such thing as perfect in this world. I think Tony and I agree on that. I think where we disagree, though, mm-hmm. is because there's no such thing as perfect, a 10 is the best you can reasonably expect to get. So a 10 shouldn't be regarded as perfect. A 10 should just be regarded as it succeeded in what it set out to do. It doesn't mean everybody's going to think it's the perfect game. It just means, like, the best you can reasonably expect.
Yeah. But you're looking at that in a very reasonable way, Brett. Like,
I think there are some people who do.
I think a lot of people just see that 10 and they just see it as we win. You know what I mean? Like, what I mean? And it doesn't seem like there's a, like, I feel like, and that's the whole reason why I've always been against the whole rating system too. It's because it just makes people lazy. And they'll never look at the review and actually figure out, okay, why is this here? They just look at the number and be like, okay, and that's it.
But you, but yeah, no. But see, the thing is, you can't stop people from being dumb. And this is just my opinion. You can't stop people from being dumb. And the problem is, this is the way I look at it. The only reason that you get more shit talking and more infighting with numbers is because you've put down a solid quantifiable context for where you stand. When you just like, well, this was good about the game, this wasn't that great, this was good, generally I feel kind of cool about it, that's real vague, and it's tough for people to be like, what do you mean you feel cool about it? I mean,
well, that's a problem of the artist. You shouldn't use that. You need to be, you need to actually explain yourself.
Well, that's what I mean. Like, you know, the more detail you be, the more people are going to disagree with your points. I think the only reason that when people kind of just give a vague review that they don't get as much shit is because there's not as much definitive stuff there to rail against. There's not enough people for like angry trolls to start slamming on their fucking keyboards. I think it's just if you don't praise what they like, they get pissed. It's as simple as that. It doesn't matter the format it's in.
Yeah, no, you're 100% right. And just to be clear, yeah, Brett is on the other side of this. I'm the literal guy. I'm like, no, if that motherfucker's 10 out of 10, that means it's fucking perfect. I've always maintained that stance, so I'm not changing that. That's why you have the Tony perfect, 95 out of 100, you know? Because there's always going to be fun. There are very few games that I consider perfect. I can count them on one hand and still have fingers left over. Like Super Mario World and probably Super Metroid are like the only ones I could think of. I'm like, there's nothing wrong with these games. They are perfect, you know? But like everything, even my beloved games, Metal Gear Solid 3, my favorite game of all time, right? That shit ain't perfect. There's fucking little imperfections in there. Resident Evil 4, love that game. Little imperfections. I as a reviewer could not justify giving those games, which I fucking adore, a 10 out of 10 with those little imperfections they have there. But you know, different styles or whatever.
Hey Tony, here's an idea. Secretly review things on a scale of 11. Just don't tell anybody you're doing it.
Yeah, but I don't like odd numbers, you know. What's up, Blitz? Hang on, did I hear that right? Okay, he, you know, little chat here. But no, I think we all agree on the fact that fanboys do use review scores as ammo.
This is what I mean, people are going to do what they're going to do, but I don't like see that, like, you know, there's plenty of games that I have read the reviews for and I'm just like, and that have had low ratings and I'm like, man, this game sounds awesome, I'm going to play this thing. You know, or if it's, I mean, not so much now because I feel like a lot of the writers, with the exception of you, Tony, kind of read very similarly, especially when it comes to reviews.
Yeah,
because they're all ChatGPT.
Yeah, because they're all ChatGPT now.
Oh my God! Yeah, that's gonna be coming for me. I think I know what Brits was fucking. I fucked them up because I said two Nintendo games were perfect. Yes, I used to like Nintendo. I just think Nintendo, as they currently stand, is fucking bullshit. But they used to do good stuff back in the day. Let me be diplomatic. I used to like them back in the day. So there you go.
The way I've always, at least traditionally, used to do it. You know, when the game magazine the era, I would still read the review regardless if it had a lower, a bad rating, just to see if like there's stuff in there that I might enjoy. And so a lot of times, you know, you have a good sense about what things you like. But I feel like, again, like it's not become about an actual review of the thing, you know, or that person's review of the thing. It's just become like, you know, another feather in your cap for the thing that you want to win. When it's really is supposed to be part of maybe, at least how I always saw it, as a part of your decision making process of buying a game, right?
Yeah. By the way, if you guys saw me doing a face, because Blitz, you just brought up the perfect example of why I hate review scores. A 96 versus a 97. Who the fuck cares at that point? This is why it's so stupid. This game's better than that one because it's 97. You just got a shitty 96. How dumb is that? It's so stupid. Or let's get even crazier, right? This game is better because it's 99.97. That game right there, 96.5. Like, what? Review scores are so fucking dumb, you know?
I've always sort of the review scores passing a test. If it's a, what was it? It's 65 is passing, right?
Not anymore.
It's a 60. So, I mean, you're passed. It's like, it's not the best, you know, you couldn't have done it the better, but you know, if you got that, then you're good. You know, it's a decent experience, you know, it has flaws.
Okay. Well, it's weird. Cause it's like language, like the whole 100 metric evolved from the whole argument that you know, there's not a perfect game, so you can't rate it, you know, nothing gets a 10. And well, that makes it so the highest you can get is a 9, and everything's between a 7 and a 9, and so we need to expand the score. But the problem is, when you put it to 100, it makes it sound oddly technical. It makes you sound like you have some fucking system by which you're grading it, and you don't. A 1 to 10 scale is a guesstimation. I think in all practice, we know that. You know, if you're like, how good's that burrito? 1 to 10 kind of just gives you a general idea. We're used to that. But then people just went, well, that's not scientific enough. Now, yeah, you get like, well, it's 96.5. Like, what the fuck did you grade that by? Like, do you have a syllabus that you're putting all games through? Or is it just, I feel like this is a 9? 96 is too specific of a fucking number to feel like.
Yeah. Also, Brett, when it gets even more granular, 96.2.
Yeah.
What are we doing here?
You know? I agree with the chat, though. Like if you're looking at like aggregates, like generally, I think people are looking at a watermark. Like, if it's above 70, it's probably going to be all right. If it's above 80, cool. If it's above 90, the general can say, like, honestly, the way I look at it is I just kind of distill it back down to tens. I'm like, all right, so it's above a 9. People generally agree this is a pretty great game. Cool.
Also, Tony, like, you never have given anything a 1, right?
No. Yeah, I would have given Resident Evil 6 a 1, but we didn't do review scores. No, if nowadays, this is kind of general. For sites that give game on a 5 scale, I've never given anything under a 2.5 because that's the lowest I can actually give something. Because it makes sense. Like, from my editor standpoint, he's like, Tony, does this game boot up? Does it work? Yes. Okay, then you can't give it a 1. I'm like, oh, you know what? That makes sense to me. So, yeah. The only way I would give something a 1 is if, like, literally I try to turn the game on and the shit don't work, you know? Or something fundamentally is broken, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, I gave was it Godfall? I gave that a, like, I was about to give that. I wanted to give that shit a 1 out. What a trash fucking game. But my editor goes, Tony, you played the game. It worked. You can't give it a 1. I'm like, yeah, that makes sense. 2.5.
I feel like we should have incomplete scores for games that hit game-breaking bugs. Like, I'd love to give this a score, but the game was so fucking broken I couldn't finish it.
Yeah, that has happened. That has happened, you know? And yeah, but it's anyway, review scores, you already know. I'm not a fan. All right. Let's see. I think we answered both parts of this question. Good stuff. All right, let's move on here. Villa Kyle. All right, this is my favorite question of the night, you know? And just to preface this, when I read this question, I was a little mad at myself because I didn't bring this up during the Thursday show. I'm like, fuck, that's such a great point. You know, this one's a little bit long, so just bear with me. Zelda Tears of the Kingdom, 720p, 900p when docked, 30 FPS plus more reuse assets and enemy types and God of War Ragnarok, whatever dare include. The same reviewer that said 30 FPS on Redfall was unacceptable in 2023 now heralds Zelda as Game of the Year. The same reviewers get on podcasts and say the Switch is in desperate need of a refresh, but Zelda is Game of the Year. Every other game that comes out is slammed for performance, but Zelda is 10 out of 10. I understand it's beloved and the gameplay might be the best thing since the MJ crying meme, but 10 out of 10, 5 out of 5. At what stage does the industry decide that there is some bullshit going on? Okay, so again, I'm not done yet. This is a little bit long one. Can we also talk about the pressure from peers and Nintendo in the video game journalism industry? Give Zelda a bad review, and that might be the last review copy you get. It's also not discussed that these same reviewers slammed the real game of the year, Harry Potter, if we talk sheer numbers over a political stance that had nothing to do with the developer prior to release. Then those same reviewers were all pissy when WB left them out of the review list. Where is the same energy for Zelda and Nintendo? All that said, Zelda looks like a good time, but when are video game journalists going to take themselves seriously and keep the same energy for all publishers and all games? 10 out of 10 means it cannot be improved. I can pinpoint to a PC mod that begs to differ. And then the last thing he says here is, Tony, I appreciate the Nintendo rants. Don't dull your blade. Sony, Microsoft, and Nintendo need the feedback, good or bad. If fans want to stick their head in the sand, we will be playing the next Zelda in 1080p 30 frames in the year 2030. So a lot there. This all comes from the fact that the game, you know, we briefly talked about this on Thursday. It's like just universal praise, right? But that was such a great fucking point. Again, I feel stupid I didn't bring it up. Redfall, right? Lambasted for being 30 frames a second, right? Zelda, 30 frames a second, greatest game of all time. Granted, there is a difference. You want a first-person shooting game to be 60 frames, right? And obviously, this is coming from Xbox, a company who has said 60 frames a second, accept no substitutes. I get that. And obviously, the Switch hardware, even when it released, was fucking dated. It can't handle anything well, you know, like that. So I get it. But that's a good point, Villa. I'm really glad you brought that up. How can you have one guy bring up, okay, Redfall, fuck this game, 30 frames a second, then give Zelda a pass, right? Me, for example, right? You know, just being transparent, I was asked, Tony, do you want to review Tears of the Kingdom? I said no, because I'm going to be the outlier. I am not going to give that game a high score because of that. Not only that, you know, because I just thought the first game was fucking overrated, but I would not, I could not get over shit like that. No 4K, no 60 frames. I wouldn't be, so I recused myself from that, you know? That was a good point he brought up there. So he's basically saying, do we need to hold games by different metrics? Yes, you do, but, you know, you should also, bring it up. Anyway, go ahead, Manny.
One thing I'd have to say is fun factor and nostalgia totally trumps any of that bullshit. You know, people get all cry and moan about like 60 frames per second and all that stuff. But for most people, if the game ends up being fun enough, or, you know, people tend to look over a lot of, you know, egregious issues. Look at all the issues that you see in a Grand Theft Auto game or a Bethesda game. But then look at all the stuff that you can do in those games, and those games end up getting higher scores than I believe they should get.
Yeah.
And I think this Zelda game, I don't think that even the last game wasn't even that glitchy. You know, I think it ran as good as it could have on that platform. And I think it's the same sort of situation. It's just like, you know, they not to mention they don't expect anything more than that from the Switch. So most of the time from the Switch department, you hear, "Wow, this is a lot better than I thought it was." Right. You know, all those games that got ported and all that stuff.
Yeah. And I think it all is definitely expectations, because Redfall and they did say it was going to be 60 frames per second, and they turned back on that.
And it will be too. It will be too eventually. You know.
Yeah. So the whole thing with that was, Redfall was lambasted before people knew it was a shit game. Only that it was 30 frames per second. That, you know, that was like the thing where it's like a deal breaker, and a lot of, you know, mostly the fanboys, you know, started off the propaganda, and it went on from there. And, you know, some credible people that were, you know, worked for sites and stuff were talking about, you know, Redfall 30 frames per second, is this game doomed and stuff like that, just based off the 30 frames per second part. But yeah, for Zelda, and that's one of my biggest, I've been playing Tears of the Kingdom. I put in, you know, since today was Mother's Day and I didn't get to play hardly anything today, I put in like 5 or 6 hours. And my biggest issue is sort of the inconsistent frame rate. And obviously it doesn't look that great on the TV. And that's my biggest issue. I wish, you know, the frame rate would have been a little bit more stable, especially when you're doing the little, I forgot what the system's called when you're putting in things together and crafting them and doing little puzzles and stuff like that. That part, it kind of dips for a lot for me. I don't know if it gets better throughout the game, but at least in the first parts of the game, when you run that certain mechanic, the whole frame rate tends to dip at places. But yeah, it's all about perception. Like Manny mentioned, if it's a game that people have 100% expectations on things, like this is what I want from Zelda and this is how they're satisfying my thirst, I guess, and frame rate is not part of that, then they'll be neglectant of it. But if it's a game they know nothing about, like Redfall, and all they know about the game is from the trailers, and it's not going to be 60 frames per second anymore, then they'll lose their shit. And it's just kind of like the nature of the beast of expectations between an established franchise and something that's starting from scratch.
Yeah. Chris, get in here, man. I want your thoughts on this.
Well, with the access stuff, Nintendo has had a stranglehold on that because of just the length of time they've been making games, and they've built up their own, mythos and history and everything. So nobody reviewing games, they're a household name, so nobody wants to lose access, right? Nobody wants to then be too critical of them to have them like, you know, have a negative response. And think about all the things they've done that nobody besides maybe some YouTubers or whatever have ever complained about. The ambassador program, which was awful. Yeah. I mean, that was literally, hey, you cannot make a video game review of our games unless A, we approve it. B, it's a title we want reviewed. And C, you cannot have really negative feedback about it. That's ridiculous. That's not a review then. That's just shilling. You're just saying, hey, unless you shill our stuff, you we're gonna flag your video, and you'll never be able to review the game.
That's not just shilling. That's simp behavior. They're doing that shit for free.
Well, now they are, but Nintendo was enforcing that. They were literally enforcing that on YouTube. But they ended it because finally enough people got hit by it, and they're like, this is absolutely ridiculous. Like, you cannot say we cannot critically review your game because you won't allow it. That's insane. So all those things, but you know, and lately they've been pretty litigious, and they're going after people more, and so I think they've made more people afraid to do that, especially reviewers. And then, like, look at lately what they did to Kotaku. They're just like, yeah, we're not giving you Zelda. You are critical of, I guess they're critical of the Mario Brothers movie or whatever, and they're just like, yeah, we're not giving you access to this game.
That's documented, by the way, people. Like, this isn't, like, again, this was also part of the reason I recused myself, because I didn't want my negative review to reflect on my website. You know what I'm saying? Like we... You know, so yeah, it's real, you know. And there's a story I also want to share, but Chris, finish what you're saying.
First. Sorry, Tony, I got to interject real quick. Because you mentioned in your negative review. By the way, a negative review would have been like an 80.
Yeah, exactly. Except, here's the thing. Chris, finish your point, and then I'll say what I got to say.
Oh, yeah, so to that point, like, that's why a lot of people are scared. Like, you know, obviously... A major site like Kotaku, I don't consider them credible or anything, and a lot of people don't, but they're still a major name in game review sites. So when they lose their access, then people are like, oh shit, all right, so you can't be too critical. And then the other side, you have the rabid fanboys, and I always think back to when Breath of the Wild came out, and I think one of the few people was critical of it, not critical like giving it, like Tony said, an 80 or whatever, but lowering the score because it's like, hey, I think it was Jim Sterling, and he said, I hate weapon fragility, yeah. And he docked points from his review. They went after this guy. His site went down for like 2 days. They DDoSed his site. They fucking sent him death threats.
This is the Nintendo fans, by the way, doing this, just to be clear.
Yeah, here. Yeah. So on one side, Nintendo kind of strong-arming you with access, and then on the other side, Nintendo fans are fucking rabid. And this was years ago. This is 2017. Mm-hmm. This is happening. Now it's even worse. You know, so with
that's
all that,
also the other reason I recuse myself. I did not want to deal with these people, man. I'm not to get too deep into it, but I had I've lost access to writing gigs because of Nintendo fans. So they're, you know, so yeah, these people are fucking rabid. Anyway, go on.
Yeah. So you have the. Things swing the other way, and people start giving the game perfect scores. It's flawless, whatever, spectacular, masterpiece. Even though it's like other games get called out for the same flaws, I'll say, like, you know, mm-hmm. like poor graphics, you know, low frame rate, all this stuff that is in this game, yet this is a perfect game, and other games are not perfect. They're not even close. And it's like, well, there's no consistency there. Then who do you trust? You have to start weaning out, like, who's credible, like either a person who's going to go, fuck this, I'm going to be honest, I'm going to say what I think about this, that's who you trust, or you just watch a streamer and you trust your own eyes, or maybe you take a chance, you pick up the game and go, yeah, well, I put this on my nice 4K TV and it looks like trash, you know. Mm-hmm. You don't need anyone's feedback. You don't need some fanboy or Nintendo telling you, hey, you know, this, we worked really hard on this game. It's like, that's nice. It still looks like ass. You have to be honest. So,
yeah. You know. No, you're right about that. And, you know, here about access and all this other stuff, you know, like, it's happened. It's documented. But I want to share this. But I got to, you know, rub out the names, obviously, you know. But I remember when Breath of the Wild came out, right? I was talking to, back then, he was an industry insider guy, very popular. A lot of sites covered him, and, you know, cited him and stuff. I was talking to him behind the scenes. He's a big Sony guy, right? And we were just talking about Horizon Zero Dawn, which had just come out. And we're talking about how fucking amazing game was and all this other stuff. And he was telling me that he talked to another journalist based out of France, I believe. And he was like, yo, why'd you give this game, you know, Breath of the Wild a 10 out of 10? And the journalist said to him, because I knew my peers were going to give this game a high score. And I had to, and I didn't want to be left out. It's like I felt this way about the game. He liked the game, you know, well enough, but he didn't feel it was a 10 out of 10. But he knew that everybody else was going to be giving it a 10 out of 10. So he felt compelled to do it. So not only do you have the threat of Nintendo cutting you off, not only do you have the threat of the fans coming after you, you also don't want to be like, you know, be the one guy that stands out among your peers, right?
Right. I mean, but that's not Nintendo's fault.
No, like, it's not. But it's all, created that way. You know what I'm saying? No, you're right. That isn't Nintendo's fault. But that is another aspect that people need to consider. And no, I am not saying that this game isn't deserving of these scores. Aside from the fact that no game, in my opinion, should get a 10 out of 10. But I'm not saying the game is bad. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying you have to consider these things when looking at the scores for this game. You know,
Brad, go first, then you go. Okay, sure.
Yeah, go ahead.
One of the things I kind of realized when I was thinking about this game is like, I think I kind of understand at least a small perspective of where some of these fans are coming from. Not that I agree with them or think that it's justified, but I think it has something along the lines of, so like, Nintendo does some things very well. They're really big on quality control of their game for the most part. They games don't have a lot of bite to them, but they're pretty polished. And they don't necessarily get influenced by the rest of the industry. What that means is that Breath of the Wild, unlike most traditional open-world games that we see today, did a really good job of like environmental directing, exploration. It just kind of has this unquantifiable kind of magic element to it that a lot of bigger publishers seem to have moved on from the idea of exploration and fun and that kind of thing. And while I don't think it's perfectly implemented, what I'm getting the sneaking suspicion is going on here is that people are so afraid that by people talking shit on Zelda, that they're trying to like encroach on this bastion of creativity that they had. And so they won't hear anything of it. They're like, nope, the game's perfect. They won't admit the game's flaws because they're afraid it's going to kind of obfuscate the thing that makes it special. And so they just throw reason out the window and just kind of be like, game's perfect. Like, no. There are things about the game that you love that doesn't make it a perfect game. It doesn't even make it a game that you love. That just means there's things about the game that are well executed and you love it. I agree with that part. I think that we need to move away from, you know, I've never been a fan of the Ubisoft, you know, climb a tower and now we see every pinpoint icon on the map. What's the point of exploring? I'm a big fan of environmental storytelling and environmental direction. Like, if you can build a hill that makes me want to crest that hill, and then put something over that hill that makes me want to go climb that mountain, you're doing a good job. And I don't think that's done a lot. So I think that people are kind of, they're so afraid to throw the baby out with the bathwater. They're so afraid that people are, you know, not going to see the forest for the trees, that they're just kind of standing on, nope, game's amazing. It's awesome. It is everything I wanted it to be. Like, no, it's just, there's some things you really like about it. It's the same thing with like Dead Island 2. Like, there's some things I really enjoyed about that game. Does it make it a great game? No, it makes it a pretty good game. And that's healthy in the range of, like, when you say it's a pretty good game, then it really depends on, is this kind of your jam? So I think they're just kind of having this knee-jerk defensive reaction, not even necessarily because of Nintendo, but because they see good in the Zelda game. And they're just trying to shove that part to the front. That's at least my personal hypothesis.
Yeah, the thing I want to bring up, because Blitz asked, Gene Park have to say, does he feel pressure to say good things? No. Here's the thing. And again, I've been doing this for 11 years, right? I can say most of those reviews that you're seeing are genuine. Most of the other reviewers that I've talked to love Nintendo. They genuinely love their games, right? So yes, I would say 95% of those reviews that you're seeing are genuine. That's what they actually feel. They have this, you know, deep like love and nostalgia for Nintendo. I've seen it. I personally don't get it. I'm like, I moved on from that. But that is their genuine opinion. I'm not saying it's disingenuous, but there is a certain percentage that do feel compelled. And again, I know these people that are like, oh, fuck, I better be careful with this score for a number of reasons. You know. But no, 95% of the reviews are absolutely genuine.
And I know you might not agree with me on this, Tony, but reviews shouldn't be about feels. Reviews should be about... criticism, constructive criticism, and like understanding the technical input that like went into making it. Like, I agree that there's always going to be bias in reviews, but you should never review a movie based on whether or not you liked it. Like, that shouldn't be the end. You should really examine the plot and the pacing and the music and the acting individually and see how well technically all of these things are done. Like, that's supposed to be what a score review is. Otherwise, it's just an editorial.
Yeah, but that's what most reviews are. And by the way, that's what's helped me with my reviews. I try to be like, okay, what is this thing trying to do? How well does it do it, right? So that's why, like Carlos said, yeah, I probably would give this game an 8 out of 10, right? But I would have, you know, again, as a reviewer, but like you said, you're trying to be objective, I would have to, on principle, knock a point down because of the fact that it's not 4K, not 60 frames. No way. No fuck. In 2023, that is unacceptable. You know, like, especially if you're paying $70 for this shit. No way. That's unfair to the customer that you're paying top money for something subpar, at least in the presentation point. You know, go ahead, Brian.
But Tony, like, this thing is, again, like, See, I actually don't like that argument because, again, the Switch is a fucking toaster. Like, this thing is essentially like 15-year-old hardware at this point. Like, yeah. It can't do that by definition. So I don't see the point in like docking things for things that it can't do. It's like me saying, oh yeah, I'm going to dock this like PS5 game because it's not running at 8K. It's like, yeah, they don't do that.
Well, because yeah, they don't have the hardware to do that. I know, I understand, but the fact that you're charging people that much, like, come on now. You like that got to be taken into account too. And remember, I've had I felt that the Switch was a bad deal from the jump because that was already dated when it came out. I'm like, you have these two systems out here and you're giving people this. To me, that's unfair, you know?
And also, not to mention, it is also running Breath of the, you know, Tears of the Kingdom at lower than what it has traditionally done. 900p, they usually run at 1080p when docked.
That's right. It's between 900p and 10. They've never really hit 1080p. You know, it's not really capable of it. But again, you know, and Blitz, this is something you kind of edited out of your original question. What I was ready to read that whole thing. It was great. And remember, I'm a professional reviewer. I'll be the first guy to tell you my review doesn't fucking matter. What matters is your opinion. What I think of a game does not fucking matter. What other people think of a game doesn't matter. Do you like the game? Yes? Great. That's all that matters. You know?
Like, I see.
Yeah. I see this. Because too many people get so hung up. It's like they like a game. They see other people may say something on it. Then they get upset. Why are you upset? Who cares? You like the game. You know,
I mean, but, yeah. I would say if you agree with, like, I would see if your opinions align with the reviewer, that would also be a helping factor for you to essentially, if you wanted to buy a game, you know, like, that's the way I've at least always traded. Like, if I, you know, in the whole scheme of reading a person's reviews, they've pretty much aligned with my thoughts on games. I'm like, okay, so this is a trusted source. Then I'll, this person's review may have a little bit more heft in it because their likes and dislikes seem to align with mine. But obviously, it's not something that always matters. But yeah, and you know, always is consistent. But yeah, in the end, it is your opinion on a game that is what is the most important thing. But it's also sort of nice to know what you're getting into when you're, you know, especially spending $70 on a fucking game, you know. That's a pretty hefty amount of money.
And Blitz mentioned in the chat, he said, as a fan of something, it gets pretty tiring to be trying to discuss it with others only to have a bunch of other people come and tell you how shit it is. Well, welcome to fandom, because that's everybody.
Yep.
Every time someone talks about something, there's always going to be people shitting on it. And, you know, Breath of the Wild is something you love. And guess what? Most people fucking love this game.
Yeah, your opinion is not like an outlier. Like, most people agree with you, you know?
I love Fallout 76.
See, there you go. That's a radically different opinion. Go ahead.
Hey, you know what? I have loved that shit since it came out. I am at least consistent.
Yes. Go ahead, Carlos.
So, yeah, you know, and I told Blitz, I'm like, hey, man, I guess you know how people might feel when they hear about you talking about Xbox. Because, you know, every time, you know, people, and let's be real, people in the chat, a lot of people give Xbox a lot of shit.
Oh, yeah.
And here in the panel as well. So, you know, sometimes we talk shit about stuff that we actually love and we wish it would be better. Like, even for me and a lot of us have been Nintendo fans for well over three decades. So, you know, a lot of this stuff is, you know, not something that we're like, oh, you know, we're fanboys and we're trying to, we wish Nintendo was doing worse, because we're really not. Most of us have a Switch. Yeah.
You want to see hate? Look at how we feel about the Stadia.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, yeah. Oh, man.
Or maybe just Phil Harrison as running video game stuff.
Yeah.
Go ahead. I'll just sum up like most of my thoughts, because they're relatively simple enough on like aspects of the whole question. So he brought up questions about review process and access and giving the game high scores. I see that quite often, where people just give games high scores just because they don't want to lose out on the access. And this is one of the things that just irritates me, because people are now scared to be honest about the game, because if they're honest about it and they don't like it, then they lose the access. Again, it seems like Nintendo's not the only one. Angry Joe has had run-in, I think, with Konami a few times about this. So it's not just a Nintendo thing, it appears to be like a general thing, and no one wants to speak about it. And it's one of the reasons why I say, and this is why I again personally say, that most reviewers are paid off, because they're paid off by giving access to the item, and hence that's them being paid off. It's like, you'll give us a good score so that we don't cut you off, i.e. that's their payment.
But the thing about it is, it's like, they're, you know, That just because they don't, you know, obviously the video games put a lot more onto review scores than the movie industry. Do, yeah. Even people have been given, reviewers have given scathing reviews to films, but they still end up going to see reviews for films. You know, they don't cut them off, but I feel like that's the precedence that the stupid aggregate sites create. With this sort of thing, having a high Metacritic score essentially can hurt hurt sales if it has a lower score. So, you know, that's why they're putting all this thing. I'm like, okay, so now you're lowering our score, but I don't know why does Angry Goat Joe part of that aggregate stuff? He's not, right?
I don't think so.
I don't think so.
No. But
Brian is right. I'm not going to say which company, but yes, that happened to me with one company. They didn't like something that my site wrote. That not even that I wrote. The site wrote, cut me off for years. I finally got access to them. I went to one of their events to play their game. Guess what happened? I gave the game a bad review because the game sucked. I didn't care.
I just disagree with that as a fundamental principle. It's like, you like access to games should not be limited.
I 100% agree with you, and that's the problem with this game industry. It's like these companies are so fucking sensitive to shit. You know,
it's ridiculous. Well, it's on both sides. I feel like they're so sensitive, and also the game sites need to just buck up and go buy the fucking game themselves and do the review. So don't fucking, like, you know, they're stipend. You know what? Just go send one of your people. You send your intern to the store and go buy the fucking game and get your review in.
Yeah, but the problem with that is you miss the review embargo, so nobody cares after that. You know,
well, to be honest, it's still pouts as part of the Metacritic score.
Yeah.
So if you're able,
not everyone.
Yeah. Well, no, I mean,
you have to be part of Metacritic itself. You know,
like Kotaku. If Kotaku gets their scores are part of the Metacritic. So
do they have scores on Kotaku? I think they got rid of scores years ago.
It's irrelevant because they don't get access to Zelda.
They should still do it regardless. Even if they're not getting those things from Nintendo, and the whole reason why they're cutting off Nintendo is because they're leaking information that Nintendo doesn't want out there.
Yeah, I gotta bring this up, man. That thing that Kotaku did when they basically like talked about the leaks and shit, that was fucking dirty, man. What kind of yellow journalism was that? You know, they literally reported on the leaks, spoiling shit. You know. But that was them being petty about it. It's like, oh, you didn't give us a game? Fuck you. We're going to do this instead. You know.
And they did the same. And they did the same thing with EA. Yeah. So it's like, you know, they released all this information about, like, you know, guess what? It's Call of Duty. Yeah. And the thing about it is like, okay, you got to understand. It's like if you're putting out information that these companies don't want out there, don't be surprised if they don't send you a review copy, buddy. Because you're doing something you're not supposed to be doing officially. I mean, granted, as a journalist, yes, you should report on all these different things, but at the same time there is consequences to that, so you can't play both sides. So buck up, buy your game, review it, that's it. You know, you're not going to get this shit for a while.
Yeah, or just don't review the game, that's it. You know,
and, you know,
because I understand the reality of it. Once a game is out, no one cares about the reviews anymore. They only care about it for one day, you know.
As long as you're, here's the thing, like, especially with big to do games like Zelda, usually that stuff lasts, like, you know, stories about it last long. So if you get something in there within that time frame, you could still be pretty good and get a little bit of those numbers.
Yeah. If you do an editorial, you'll be fine. But here's the thing. No, there is no site I've ever written for where reviews get a lot of hits. Reviews in general. It's interesting to me how, like, reviews don't get hits on sites, yet that's the thing that most fanboys cling to the most. Reviews and review scores. That is literally like any website I've written for, reviews are the thing that gets the least amount of traffic, you know?
And this is also why, you know, a lot of companies are letting go of their review teams because they're not getting the numbers that some of their spicy articles would get.
Yeah. But at the same time, you need the reviews to, as a basis for what you write about the game after the fact. But, you know, it is what it is. Anyway, any last thoughts on this?
Yeah, just real quick, the whole thing about, and you guys touched on this, the whole thing about Nintendo knows who they're serving these review copies to. They know that the overwhelming majority of the people freaking love Zelda, and they're gonna and whatever this game is, whatever its flaws is, they're gonna love this game regardless because they're huge Zelda fans, and that's just how, and that's their way to sort of. gaming the system in a way. It's like they know who they're sending to, and they know they're going to get super high reviews. Like, I'm looking at the Metacritic right now. There's so many fucking hundreds, man. I'm like, really? And this is two games in a row? So, you know, I'm just skeptical about, like, just when people just give things 100. I'm not a completely like Tony when it comes like to hundreds and tens. But I'm leaning more towards Tony. It's like 100 is perfect, man. 100 means it's fucking flawless. And you know, I've been playing the game, and I played Breath of the Wild. It's a great game. Don't get me wrong. It's fun. I get why people love this game. Some of the stuff that they've added has been really good. So, but 100, it's like, and obviously it's an opinion, but I'm just like trying to put myself into that kind of line thinking. It's like, would I give it 100? And I'm like, probably not. 90, sure. But it's like, damn, so many fucking hundreds. But it's neither here nor there.
Yeah.
I think, again, like, the funny thing is that how Carlos and Tony are feeling about Breath of the Wild is how I feel about a large majority of PlayStation exclusives. It's like, why is everyone getting, like, giving this game such a high score where it's not really doing anything all that exciting. You know, it's just doing what I consider to be the bare minimum for like AAA games. So again, I'll take example God of War or Dad of War, the new one. I really took a massive onus on certain people out there that called it the game of the generation. I was like, look, that's what are you talking about? Like,
by the way, none of us here did that.
Yeah, nope.
Yes, it's no one here, no one on the panel. It's someone else who's a massive shill. And I'll keep on telling him a shill. I don't care. I will call him a shill because he said that Saints Row isn't that bad. And it's like, nope, you're
wrong. That's fine, Mords.
So yeah, I take massive onus on people that take a game and then give like incredibly high praises where I think it's not warranted. And again, it seems like people on the panel do the same thing for Zelda. Again, totally fine. We can agree and disagree all day long. But I don't think that this is a uniquely Zelda problem. It seems to be that there are certain industry darlings out there that somehow don't really get the criticism that people believe that they deserve. Zelda's one of them. It seems like Dad of War is strongly becoming one of those as well. The Last of Us, I would have said it would be until Last of Us 2 came out, and that was very weirdly reviewed. GTA is also one where somehow people just love to throw tens at that game when people just like, hey, it has issues here and there. So I'm not saying that this is a uniquely Zelda problem. It just seems to be that they're just weirdly few amount of games out there that somehow just get bulletproof to criticism. And it's very strange to me. And personally, I don't like it. But I think it'll just continue because that's the way the industry is at this point. And unless we get rid of review scores, which I have no idea how we can, but unless we do, then this problem will just carry on until the end, I guess.
Yeah. My God, Brian, GTA released as only half a game and still got tens.
They said that they would have multiplayer, and I was so excited, and then said, yeah, it's coming in like 2 weeks after launch. It's like, I took a day off for this, mate. Come on, what are you doing? Like, I was so annoyed. And even then, when it launched, it was, oh, Tony, you remember how it was on launch day.
Yeah.
Like, GTA 5 multiplayer was just awful.
Yeah, it didn't work. But the thing is, like, for me, like, the thing I wanted worked, so whatever,
There it is. Yeah. There it is. He said it.
Yeah, I admit it.
Okay, so here's the thing. That's what I've been talking about. People will fucking champion a game if it does one thing really well, and they like that thing. Like, for you, GTA got a 10, because you didn't care about multiplayer.
Not a 10, not a 10, not a 10.
No. Okay. Yeah. I didn't mean that was hyperbolic. Tony doesn't actually give things tens,
nope.
But like it gets a good score, and that doesn't really drag it down in your personal eyes. I know you're professional enough to set that aside when you're doing reviews.
Yeah.
But what I'm saying is like your knee jerk reaction is like that game did what I want really well, and just kind of gloss over a lot of the rest. You know, God of War is another perfect, another great example. Were the fighting mechanics in God of War really that good? No, it told a baller story and looked super shiny doing it.
Yep.
Right. Like, and if that's your jam, then that's great. But it doesn't mean that it's otherwise perfect. You know, Last of Us told a really heavy story, but like, was the rest of it really tens? Like, think back, because no, it wasn't.
Man, I'm glad I didn't review The Last of Us 2. Man, I would have got lambasted by the fucking. I would have went in. You know.
Well, technically, you did review it, but it was in a podcast.
Yeah, that's true. Well, I'm talking about the second one. Did we do a spoiler for that? I didn't even remember. Shit.
Was Riku-san one the only one and Taylor Lyles?
Oh, shit. Wow, I totally don't even remember that.
It was 3 years ago, so it's been a while. Yeah,
that was during the pandemic, so all that shit is gone. Yep.
Let me ask the chat real quick. How many of y'all have built a mech yet?
Whoever's playing Tears of the Kingdom. By the way, real quick, I just want to go ahead, Carlos. I want to answer something Jay Shep asked me.
I have it, and I'm talking to Blitz about it right now in the chat. I'm only like a couple of hours in, so it's not like I'm gotten that far and gotten all the necessary tools to build like all the crazy shit. The only thing that's worrying me about this game is that I worry that the game is just over reliant on building, because at so far in the beginning of the game, All of the shrines, all of the different platforming stuff, it's all dependent on building stuff. So it kind of worries me. I'm like, it's the mechanic is really good, but it just worries me that everything is just build this to get over here, build this to get over here, build this to solve this puzzle, build this to defeat this enemy, build this to get this hidden item. So that's the only thing that worries me. It's like it's too overly reliant on the building mechanic. But I haven't gotten that far, so I can't really say that that's what this whole game is. But it's just one of those things that kind of worries me.
Yeah. Real quick, Jay Shep asks, how much do review scores affect Game of the Year votes? Again, every site does Game of the Year very differently. There is no consensus where everybody comes together and be like, hey, we're going to do this. But if you're talking about the Jeff Keighley Awards, I don't know. I don't know how that functions. But yeah, generally speaking, every site does their own Game of the Year very differently from another. There is no, again, I notice you always ask me these questions like, what's the consensus of this? What's the consensus of that? Generally, there isn't a consensus. There is no like body where like every game journalist comes together and starts talking a bunch. That doesn't exist, you know? So yeah, every site does things differently, but I can guarantee you this game's going to be Game of the Year across the board everywhere, right? It's guaranteed, you know? Yeah. Anyway, anything else you guys want to bring up on this? All right, let's move on. Yeah, because we still got a bunch more questions, you know. But okay, Mob Hits. Okay, Mob Hits, you asked this question like before, but I'll bring it up again, you know, because we're talking about Tears of the Kingdom now. Is Tears of the Kingdom a copy and paste from its predecessor?
No. No, it's not. It's It does have sort of a same feel. It feels like Breath of the Wild Part 2, but as far as, you know, just the mechanics, like I mentioned before, the whole building thing is just something completely different from what Breath of the Wild was. And all of the puzzles are sort of, and the shrines are predicated upon that. So, yeah, I wouldn't go as far as saying, no, it's the same game. It definitely has its own flair. And then obviously the map's different. It's a vertical map now.
Yeah. All right.
Inflammatory question.
Yes.
Could it have been a DLC?
Oh boy, we got a question about that too. By the way. Oh man. Oh, by the way, could it have been a DLC? No, it's a full game. You know, it's a full game.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let's see here. Mob Hits, another one. What metrics do publishers use when determining if a game should cost $70? The metric they use is, will people pay $70 or not? That's really much it. You know, I don't think there is like any internal thing where they're like, okay, this game has this, this, and that. Charge them $70. They're just like, hey, throw $70 out there. Oh, shit, they bought it.
Keep doing it.
But the excuse they use is like, oh yeah, higher frame rates, higher resolution, all this other stuff. Zelda doesn't use these excuses. They just go, the game's better, you know, or some bullshit.
I think it really depends on how corporate bonuses are structured.
Okay, continue.
I mean, if you get the performance bonuses that you're close to, and you can get them over the line by hitting your end of year numbers by putting the game at $70, well, are you going to go without your yacht?
Yeah, that's speculation. We don't know.
It's all about margins. You know, however much margin you can get off of something. And however much you can squeeze off of, they'll do it if they can.
Yeah, I think some people do it because they know they can get away with it, you know?
Well,
yeah.
No, they're not doing it for funsies or because they like being evil. They're doing it for more money, which comes in the form of bonuses.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, bonuses, it's all the same. It's like bonuses, it's stock price increases, everything, you know, as much as they can improve on the margins for anything, any type of product, they'll try to do. You know, at the beginning of the generation when Sony was like, Sony and I think another company were like lying in the sand saying, yeah, the games are going to be $70. And then the other company's like, you can do that. So it's like that. We're going to do that too.
And you all said I was crazy. Yeah, when I was like, Sony's doing it, and everybody's going to do it, just you watch. And everybody was like, no.
Nah, we agree with you.
Not you guys, but
yeah,
like
other people, yeah. All right. Next up here. All right, some sponsored questions in early. Very generous guy again, Mr. Romu Death is sponsoring some more J-Shep questions. First one, could a live-action Zelda movie ever live up to the franchise's standards?
No, because Link would need to talk.
Yeah.
And that just wouldn't feel right.
Excuse me, princess.
Oh, you beat me to it.
Oh, by the way, I got one. I got a Carlos thing.
Uh-oh.
Yo. And I guess I didn't notice this in Breath of the Wild, but Zelda's voice acting is so bad. It's one of those fake British accents.
Uh-oh.
It's like, an American doing a British accent thing. I'm like, man, again? And I was kind of turned off, but yeah, that's that's one of those things. My bad.
Yeah. This about the $70 thing, I want to go back real quick. Blitz says, I think most people equate higher resolution, etc., to higher price. $70 could also factor in time and number of people involved to make said game and content of game. Yeah, but we're not having that conversation, you know? No one's really talking about that. Because we've kind of touched on it before. It's like, theoretically, like a game like Elden Ring, you should be able to charge $100 for it, for the shit you could do. But, no, you know, that's not going to happen.
I mean, you know, I have problems believing that when I see huge, expansive games put out by five-person teams. Like, I don't think... I think the problem here is, like, if you're trying to find real talent and you have to hire 10 people to find that real, just nail-that-shit-down talent that you're looking for, that doesn't necessarily mean you won't need all 10 people. You need the ones that made the difference. And I think that a lot of big companies will just put 80 people in a room and look at the, you know, community of talent and just be like, yeah, that's what we need. But then you can point to other games and like, there's like five really talented people making this game and it looks absolutely the tits. So like,
can you give us some examples?
No Man's Sky, eventually. fuck. I played a lot of them recently where they were like, between like 5 and 20 people teams.
Yeah.
That's actually not that uncommon. I want to say the first Hellblade was a pretty small team. So like, and then they're not generally the giant AAA ones, but like being able to see what, you know, even some people like teams of two or three people, individual creators, like if you look on Steam, they can make some absolutely baller stuff, especially with Unreal 5 coming out. I'm not sure that they need all of these people. But again, like the whole corporate structure and the way of corporate game making or corporate production of any kind of art asset, really, it's not the most efficient because you can't really trust middle management to be able to correctly identify key talent and necessarily move them up the way they need to. They just kind of have to cast a wide net. I'd actually be interested to hear Manny's thoughts on that since he's worked in a talent-driven agency controlled by middle management at points himself.
What was the question again?
I think a lot of times when people are trying to make something really high bar with a lot of top level, you know, with a lot of talent, they'll hire on more people than they need to. They'll hire 10 people and they'll be like, cool, we have a huge talent pool. Mm-hmm. And not necessarily be able to identify that it's three people of that 10 people team that are almost the entirety of that talent. And that's why small game teams are able to come up with some really good stuff is just because
there's not when it comes to bigger teams, you know, granted you're able to throw bodies at solutions, but if you ever notice, like, usually smaller games always have simpler solutions when it comes to, you know, making these sorts of games. So it's like, okay, you know, we know our scope. Well, we're not trying to make an ultra massively open world, or we have an open world that's sort of slightly limited, but it's always balanced based on the people that they have available for it. You know, it's very rare when you have like an independent company making an open world game on the level of like a Skyrim. You know,
I don't know that anybody makes like, and that's, and I see your comment there, Proto. Like, I, He said, just wait until Bethesda releases a $70 game on the same 30-year-old engine with a litany of bugs to evolve gameplay and modern necessities to fix the game. Modern necessities to fix the game for them. I think he means modern. Modders. Yeah. I mean, here's the thing, man. You're not 100% wrong. But the other thing is, Skyrim is one of the most beloved and well-sold games in fucking history that has been selling for over a decade. So clearly they're doing something right.
Yeah, but I feel like it also like they're allowed to have their sort of scope like that. And I feel also with the era of open world game, right? Like if you were making an open world, like if you look at the team of the original Grand Theft Auto, the open world version of it, right? You know, like the 3D open world and Skyrim, they didn't have thousands and thousands of people on there because their scope sort of matched the fidelity also matched the scope. They could do that because they didn't have to worry about doing hyper detailed models. You know, they could leverage a lot of that sort of stuff too. So they could cut the corners what they need to and still provide a very interesting thing. I almost like, imagine if, you know, graphics weren't totally a thing and how massive they could make a game like, you know, Bethesda could make a game if they made it in the same fidelity as the original one. You know,
yeah.
Because you wouldn't need to have all those artists working. Like you would have all these artists literally creating assets, like quickly being able to make all these sorts of assets and things. But obviously, as the eras go on, you know, there's more expectations as to the fidelity of the world and you know the size of the world.
Yeah, and that may be a problem. Like I'm really torn because like. I know people will criticize the fidelity, especially if the thing, if it doesn't hit certain fidelity or performance things. But like that concerns me a little bit because Todd Howard's straight up said that's not what they're going for when they're making these games. That's not what they're concerned about, and that'll be the first thing that they sacrifice in order to get an experience that they want to get.
But like at the same time, if you look at the tradition of the sort of Bethesda games, I mean. Excuse me, and like Starfield is probably the most beautiful Bethesda game they're making, you know, like, but you know, the other games obviously weren't lookers, but the thing about them was the fact of how much you could actually do in the game, like all the different stories and side quests and things, you know. It's sort of the same thing I was talking about before when it was like how people can sort of excuse glitchy games, but there's the size of the game or the fun factor of the game sort of trumps any of all that sort of stuff. People just sort of forget it because everything, the whole is actually better than that one little, you know, broken part of it.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Let's move on. Next question here. Phil Spencer stated the importance of digital libraries in his recent interview with Kind of Funny. Knowing how important digital libraries are now, should we expect any future gen consoles to be backwards compatible? As long as they're on x86 architecture, they will be, you know?
Yeah.
So I think that's going to be the norms. And by the way, I'm talking about specifically Xbox and PlayStation. Nintendo, they're going to reset every single time. That's what they do. You know,
yeah,
buy everything reset again,
reset every single time and then resell you all a bunch of all the older games.
I mean, look at the Switch. One of its biggest selling games is a Wii U game.
Yep.
Technically Wii U too, game. If you think about it, Breath of the Wild's a Wii U game. Yeah, a lot of them, you know, but so Nintendo, they're going to keep, you know, again. You know what? Forget it. I was going to go off on another Nintendo rant, but I think you had enough of that for me tonight. But yeah, from Xbox and PlayStation, you will keep getting backwards compatibility. At least with PlayStation up until the PS4 and Xbox all the way back, you know?
Yeah. Granted, the good thing about the Xbox is that most of their games have been x86, so their library goes a lot further back than PlayStation does.
All the way back, yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's gonna be the norm now. So yep, there you go. Next up, Black Mage. All right. Phil Spencer said Xbox has lost the console wars, but is Xbox too big to fail? What I mean is, if Xbox goes under, would it have a negative impact on the current gaming market? Yeah, because then Sony would just run wild shot. Like, we don't want that, you know?
Yeah, hold on. Did Phil Spencer say that?
Yeah, he did. Basically. He said we can't out-console Nintendo and PlayStation. He did say that.
Yeah, and yeah, not so many words.
He said we are in third place, and we're not trying to get in first place. He said these things.
He didn't say he's not trying to get in first place. The context is important. They still want to get into first place. They're just not going to do it strictly by games alone. That's all he said.
No. They said in the console space, they're never going to be.
Yeah, he did say that. Yeah, he did say that in the console space.
The thing about it is he did say
they lost a console war, basically.
No, he's saying that they need streaming services to win it.
No, he said we're not going to win in the console space. He said that. So we're going to try this other avenue. That's what he said. So
yeah. Am I thinking about a different conversation?
No, yeah, no, I think you're thinking about it differently. Again, because we're talking about consoles. We're not talking about all that. We're talking about consoles. He specifically said, we cannot out-console Nintendo and Sony. We cannot win in the console space. He said that.
With games alone. Yeah, the whole context was in the context of, well, why don't you just release great games and that'll win you the war? And he was saying that we can do that and we still wouldn't win the war.
Yeah. So, there you go. There's your defeat right there.
Oh my God! That is not what I just said.
That is literally what you just said. You said
they cannot win the console war by only releasing good games. You need to say the whole thing.
Yeah, but he already said we've already lost this. Like, we can't out console them. He said that already.
He said that's the whole point of Game Pass. It's a different avenue for them to be a viable competitor.
Yeah, but the whole Game Pass thing is still part of their console thing.
Yeah, by the way, Jay Shepsos says, tell Brett in the CMA report, Microsoft specifically said that they are buying Activision Blizzard to pivot away from consoles.
Okay.
Anyway, let's not get hung up on this point. Would it be bad if Microsoft left the console space? Yes, it would be.
Yeah,
absolutely. I disagree because obviously that does help the whole situation, but at the same time, for them, just if that was to be honest, that's sort of what they're doing.
It's going to happen. We've discussed it. It's going to happen. Like, they will become a
publisher. I think Xbox, if anything, is just going to become a service. And again, like, I feel like that would be them leaving the console space, wouldn't it be?
Yeah. Yeah, it would be.
Not making a console be leaving them the console space? Them leaving the console space?
What if they didn't? What if they just stopped making them? It would save them a lot of money.
Then I would agree. That is exiting the console space. But I don't think they're done fighting for consoles. They just know that they're in last, and they know that.
But would it necessarily be a bad thing if they just decided to not make any more Xboxes?
Yes, it would be very bad.
I think less competition is better.
Yeah, man, you got to see it that way. Yeah.
No, I'm saying obviously less competition is bad, but being that they're not making any more boxes, they still have this service, which is still sort of in competition, but not really.
Yeah, no, but here's the thing. You can't see it as, would it be bad for Xbox? That's not the question. The question is, would it be bad for the industry? I think it would be.
Yeah, it would be. Absolutely.
Because you don't want Sony just being the only dominant player, you know?
Oh, yeah. I know.
Because you'll get complacency. You'll get poor decisions in terms of like DRM or accessibility and all this stuff. Without a counterweight, without a competitor going, hey, that we're going to move in this direction, and people adopt that and go, oh, that's the way to go, and what we were doing is wrong, and you change how you operate. Without that, then you have Sony running hog wild. Or without, even if Xbox has said, hey, we're not going to make any more boxes, we're going to focus on cloud streaming, Game Pass, right? Well, if Steam Deck and Asus and all these guys go, hey, we're going to adopt that, or we're going to feature our handhelds with Xbox Game Cloud, and that's going to be the featured thing. We're going to simplify it with Xbox Game Cloud, and it starts catching on, right? Where does that leave Nintendo, right? It's like, oh, well, we have this kind of, you know, five generation old hardware that can't possibly run this game cloud, and we try. So what are they going to do? Maybe the next iteration they'll actually make something that can, you know, run it properly. And what's Sony going to do? Either they're going to A, step up their PlayStation Now service and try to compete, or B, go, ah, shit, you know, what do we do in this case? We can't, if we can't compete with them, maybe we have to give them access, or maybe we need to rethink how we do our services. You need them thinking this way. If you remove Microsoft from that equation, then they're not thinking about that. Then they're stuck in their own business model, and then things start getting bad, and we end up paying the price.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know what? Let's just go straight to the next question, because it's related to this. Jay Shep. All right. First one here from him. I've seen a lot of Twitter posts suggesting that Xbox should or will go third party one day. My question is, taking Xbox's inconsistent game releases and the recent inability to create great AAA games under consideration, could Microsoft or Xbox even be successful as a third party publisher? And by success, I don't mean player engagement. Thank you for adding that. Yeah, could Xbox succeed as a third party, given their inconsistent releases?
As they stand now?
Yeah.
No?
And I agree
with that. I mean,
yeah.
They're not producing they're not publishing quality titles. I mean, there are tons of, like, I guess if Ubisoft could do it, they could probably do it, but, like...
Yeah, but the thing is, like, and you know this, Brett, like, Ubisoft releases way more games than Xbox does, you know?
Yeah, I'm just thinking about, like, the quality of games lately, but, like, yeah, they straight up haven't been performing in the game space. I think everybody agrees with that.
Yep. So, yeah, no, they wouldn't succeed. They'd be, I've said this before, like, if Xbox was its own independent thing outside of Microsoft, it would have failed years ago. Last generation would have killed it instantly, you know? All right, next question here from Mr. Jay Shep. PlayStation has closed smaller studios, with Pixelopolis being the most recent, right after acquiring Firewalk Studios. Is this a sign that PlayStation is doubling its focus on AAA games? If so, what effect could this have on indie developers and the indie community as it relates to PlayStation? Yeah, I mean, Jim Ryan flat out said that. He's like, we want to focus on the big games. That's why we had Japan Studio close, you know? And... you know, you need these small studios around. And it's kind of sad that Sony championed these studios, you know, for years. And now with Mr. Jim Ryan, it's like, nah, just the AAA games, you know? It's bad thinking, you know?
What about you? I agree with that 100%. And Jim Ryan has made some very poor decisions as he's taken over Sony. And that's one of them. You need to foster the smaller studios and indie developers. Like Sony was doing that in the beginning. In the PS3 days, actually were giving money to indie developers and actually reducing the cost of developing on PlayStation. And now here Bloodborne. He comes and he's like, well, what?
He said Bloodborne.
Bloodborne, yeah. Well, he's just like, fuck that. We just want big ideas and huge budgets. What do you think? Those big ideas fail when they stagnate in their own ideas. Those franchises can't pan out in the long term without fresh ideas, right? And you're just saying, well, we're just going to squeeze those out or close those down because who needs them? Fucking stupid.
Yeah,
that's where your ideas, your creativity comes from the you know, you need double A. And I've said this before, like just having this divide between indie developers and then AAA games and then the double A, the middle tier studios, where you would have guys come up organically through stuff and grow the studios to the point where it's like they get the attention of a Microsoft or whatever, and then they get purchased to keep creating those things or leverage the talent. Well, that's not there anymore. He's taking the opposite approach. He's like, I'm just going to shut them down. You know, that's ridiculous. Where would you foster the talent from then? You just make the divide worse.
Yeah, no, you're 100% right. All right. Oh, by the way, is it because Jay Shep wrote it as one word? it looks like Pixelopolis, but is it actually Pixel Opus? Because I'm not familiar with the studio, just being honest. Is it Pixel Opus or Pixelopolis? I'm being fully transparent. I don't know the studio. Pixel Opus. Okay, thank you. All right, now I know. And knowing is half the battle. By the way, I threw that line at my niece and nephew. They didn't know what the fuck I was talking about.
They don't know G.I. Joe. Well, that's also Hasbro's fault for not putting anything out.
You're right about that. Because I'm pretty sure they know Thundercats at least had a cartoon a couple years ago, you know?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Another sponsor question. I like this guy. Eurocar is a good guy, you know? Good taste in food. So he's sponsoring a Mob Hits question. This one's kind of fun. What's up with Japanese developers having their characters have special abilities in their right arm? I wish he would have given some examples. Like, I guess buying a Nintendo or something.
Tears of the Kingdom. The Devil May Cry 4.
Oh, Nero.
Yeah.
Was it God Hand? Was it
God Hand? Yeah.
God Hand.
Yeah.
Was the one that just came out like last couple months, Manny, that Julia liked?
The Hi-Fi Rush. Yeah, he's the right hand. Yeah,
Hi-Fi Rush.
My initial reaction is like, yeah, because your right arm is like your dominant arm, so you would have your special power in your dominant arm. But yeah, I like that question. That was fun. Any other examples?
Oh man, jeez.
There's probably a bunch more.
Was it Bioshock, one of them? I mean, it wasn't Japanese, but...
Not Japanese, though. But yeah, you know, the right arm's your, you know, for most people, dominant arm. All right, moving on here.
What's up? We live longer, technically.
Oh, yeah? They live longer or left-handed?
Yeah, statistically, right people live longer than left-handed people. It's weird.
Yeah. All right, Mr. Ace Ali... he goes to each of you. Oh boy!
Oh,
but you know we'll answer it as a panel, obviously. How different must a game be from its sequel to escape the DLC stigma? Racing games are minimally different from each iteration, but nobody seems to mind. Most shooters with sequels are fairly iterative when the developer doesn't change. Sports games in general are fairly unchanged year over year. Fighting games often keep a lot of the same characters and movesets time and time again. Somehow, when an action-adventure game has a sequel that builds and or expands upon most of the predecessor's mechanics, it's not changed enough to justify itself. Is there some formula or criteria you look for to determine if a sequel is different enough, or do you just pick up what games franchise interests you regardless?
A little bit of column A, a little bit of column B, to be honest. Like, I feel like I know that God of War got the second God of War got a lot of anger over like them using or reusing animations and stuff, which I think those are superfluous. That game was way more than any sort of DLC. You know what I mean?
Yeah. My thing is, I don't like this narrative. And it seems like it's something new. Correct me if I'm wrong. It seems like this whole like, oh, it's just DLC as something that's like really come up in the last 5 years or so.
No.
Yeah, well, yeah. Because...
I'm asking. Because I understand DLCs as are new relatively. But go ahead, Brian. School me.
Bro, I've been saying for years.
Example.
Huh?
Yeah, okay. It's been happening for years. Like, it happened when... Sledgehammer made Modern Warfare 3. Like, there was a huge uproar about how it's just Modern Warfare 2 DLC, and that was back in like the PS3 days. That was back when God of War 3 came out, and it was just like dragged through the coals since then. And that's why I still say it, because it's pretty much the same game.
Or Second Light, which I did like better than the actual game, but it was just a DLC.
Second Light was a DLC.
It was a DLC, and it was sold as a single title. You can play it as both.
Yeah, just like Miles Morales. But yeah, no, but Brian, but thank you for asking, because I honestly didn't know. Because like I'm just saying, from my experience, I've only really heard this in the last 5 years. But I assume it must have been going on for longer than that. You know? Go ahead, Brett.
I've been saying this on this show for more than 5 years, bro.
Yeah. Oh, you have, but you know, I just assumed that was a Brett thing. to be honest. You know. But generally, and you know, again, you've seen the show. I don't like that term generally, even though some games do deserve it. Like motherfucking Miles Morales, great game, great game. That shit is DLC. You know, but my thing is, because everybody does have kind of durable criteria, my thing is like, if it's as big as an actual game, then it's not DLC. Like Miles Morales, that's pretty much the entire, it's a microcosm of Spider-Man. It's a smaller experience, you know?
What about the games that do have DLCs bigger than that?
Examples.
Fallout Broken Steel.
Broken Steel is not as big as the main game.
No, but it's as big as some of these games that you say, like, it is as big as
Morales. Yeah, you know, okay, that's a great question. No, it has to be, if it's as big as the main game, then it's DLC. Well, I mean, it's not DLC, you know what I'm saying? It's like, but I can't be like, hey, this DLC is bigger than this DLC, therefore it's a, you know, I'm not going
to
do that.
Okay, so it's not like it has to hit X amount of hours. It's in relation to the original game size.
Yes, or the previous game. Yeah, you're right, because you're right. Like, Broken Steel is way bigger than fucking Miles Morales, but it is still DLC in comparison to Fallout, you know?
That makes sense. That tracks.
Yeah.
I mean, personally, here's where I come at it. It, for me, it's could it be? Because I have seen some massive DLC, right? But like, if you're using mostly all the same assets, mostly the same game world, the same graphics, and there are not really any huge mechanical system updates, then I'm kind of the mindset of like, here's where I divide it. And not is it or isn't it? I divide it as could it be? Like, you already have the main game that has all of the basic stuff, all you're doing. You're not even setting through a whole lot of new assets. You're just, a couple new patch jobs, a couple new wallpapers, different colored enemy types, that kind of thing. So, for me, it has to do with how far off it is, right? Like, so, Fallout 76 could have been DLC, except for the fact, like, it's got a huge new map. It's got a lot of different assets. And the basic functionality changed significantly with multiplayer, just in terms of just straight how the game functioned behind the scenes. So that for me is like right on the edge. But I've seen like game worlds almost as big as the original game world with new armors and new weapon types and all that stuff be DLC. I've seen it happen. So to me, back in the day when you came out with a new game, there was usually some sort of fidelity or mechanical upgrade to it. You know, like this feels like a step forward to next iteration. If it doesn't feel like it's a new game because it's made of all the parts of the old game, it kind of feels like if it walks like a duck, quacks like a duck kind of thing. Like, it's not made of anything new. It's not doing anything new. It's just a continuation of where the last one left off. In my opinion, that could be DLC. I think the new Zelda kind of it straddles the line. I don't know how much they had to overhaul the system to get this building mechanic to work, but judging by the fact that they're reusing the assets and the main landmass, I'm guessing not that much, which means I'm guessing it could have been a DLC, which maybe means just like it didn't need a separate launcher. And maybe it costs $20 less. I'm not saying anything to the value of the game other than I feel like it probably could have been pushed through a DLC in terms of, like, it's technically possible that this could have been a DLC if they wanted it to be. When you cross the line of, well, even if they wanted this to be a DLC, it does, you know, a pretty major overhaul of the original game. Like, nah, that's not going to count then. At least that's where I stand.
Yeah, interesting. All right, you know what? Yeah, let's go with it. Let's go down the line here. Carlos, what do you consider DLC?
It's a combination of all the things, because like you mentioned, Tony, it all depends on the game. Because the whole Brotherhood of Steel? No, not the Brotherhood of Steel. That DLC for Fallout 3. Way bigger than
Steel is one of them. Yeah.
Yeah, it's way bigger than Miles Morales, but both are DLCs. So, you know, and the whole thing where it has to be the same size as the previous one, I don't know if I agree with, because, you know, it could be a different type of game. Like, for example,
I should add, if it's as big as the previous game and tells a brand new story, that's a new game, you know? Like, if it's like God of War, it's continuing the story, you know, and you get brand new worlds and everything. The thing is, like, again, I don't like that. Oh, it has the same mechanics, therefore it's not a sequel. Then no Mega Man game is a sequel. Then they're all, the first six Mega Man games are all basically the same, right? Like, but they are sequels. That's why.
No, they were graphically updated.
No, not really. Not on NES. They're all. The only difference is, like, they had different bosses and new story, obviously. But mechanically, and they added some little things here and there. But they were basically the same game. That's why I feel very uncomfortable going, it's same mechanics DLC. You know. Anyway, go on, Carlos.
I feel like if DLC is getting an established game. And still requiring that game to work, and it's significantly less in terms of just story, gameplay, or, you know, traversal, whatever, just a lot less than what the previous one or what the mainline thing is. So, because, you know, you can have a game like I'm trying to come up with an example, but you can have an original game that has a quote unquote sequel. The sequel can be half the length of it, but it's a completely different story, different game mechanics. And it just feels like a different game. Like, you know, I'm just thinking about Resident Evil. Resident Evil has gone through so many freaking different weird and strange iterations. Like Resident Evil 3.
That's a ton of mechanical changes though. I don't know. That's some overhaul stuff. Would you really call that even under the umbrella of possible?
No. But I'm not doubting the mechanics and that stuff. What I'm saying is, if we're just using size as a comparison, it's like, hey, you know, the previous game was a 20-hour experience, and this game is only a 5-hour experience. Well, that means it's a DLC. But I'm like, well, I mean, you know, Resident Evil 3 doesn't really seem nothing like Resident Evil 2. But it's way less. It's way shorter,
but it's more advanced.
Even Resident Evil 7 is shorter than Resident Evil 6. But yeah, Resident Evil 6
about that game.
Not 6, you know. It's an interesting thing, game. You know. Ace Ali asked it. I think he was right to ask, "What do you each of us think?" Because it is. It seems like it's like different for everybody. You know.
Yeah.
So let me ask you guys, does it change the nature of the question if you change the question to could it be a DLC?
I dismiss it instantly because I don't like that premise, you know?
All right.
That's my main thing. I mean, you know, Brett, I'm not saying it's invalid. I'm saying for me, I don't like asking could it. I don't care what it could be.
No, not even in the hypotheticals. Not even the hypotheticals. Just to determine, like, did this game have to be or did they make the choice for it to be? I think that's kind of a we're just talking, like, technical limitations, like, did this have to be a DLC or have to be a sequel out of necessity, or did they make that choice?
Yeah, no, I see what you're saying, but to me, that's irrelevant.
Well, okay.
Especially looking at it from our lenses, where we see that every company is making it because they want to make more money, not because there's an artistic choice in mm-hmm. creating a sequel.
Yes, Jay Shep, and I agree with this. Goes really great show tonight. Really good questions from everyone. Yeah, great questions tonight, guys. You guys are fucking awesome.
Give yourself a round of applause.
Yeah, you guys. This is your show. You know, yeah, man. We're not doing shit.
So Tony,
yo, what's up?
The Elden Ring DLC that's coming—that's reported to be almost as big as the original game. Should it be a sequel?
I don't know, man. I have to play for myself, and I'll let you know.
Because I'm wondering if you come at it from the other side where you've played DLCs that you're like, this should be its own game.
Yeah, I haven't gotten to... I mean, I'll play it and I'll let you know. I can't answer that right now without playing it, you know?
No, have you ever played any games that you feel the DLC could have been its own game?
No.
Okay.
Not yet. I play some DLCs that are fucking dope as shit, but it never... I'm like, this could have been a sequel. Like, because most of the DLCs I've played, they're just like... They just feel like slices...
Ooh, Kishak brought up a good one. Witcher 3 Blood and Wine. That I agree. That probably could have been its own game.
Yeah, no, a lot of people say that. I haven't played The Witcher, so I don't know. But a lot of people say those games are as big, you know, DLCs are as big as actual real games, you know, which is interesting. Let's move on down the line here. Brian, what do you consider DLC?
To me, I think it has to be like a mix of things, and I think this is where I had the issue with like Dad of War 2. First thing is it needs to be a new story, not exactly a continuation of the existing story as such. It doesn't have to, it shouldn't feel like a part two to something. It should be like, okay, this is like the next chapter or like the next book in the series per se. So if you take stuff like, let's see, Infamous 1 and Infamous 2, you know, like Infamous 1 is like, okay, this is the origin story, and then Infamous 2, this is the like the next chapter, like, okay, you now been, you now is, you are established now, so let's see like your first actual villain you fight against, like that type of thing, where it's like, okay, this is like something else added to it, like beyond as such. The issue is that, again, racing games don't really work with this, because again, racing games don't do that. But then again, you could say something like, with a racing game, it's a different locale, different location. You know, it's not the same place. For example, Forza Horizon 4 and 5. So I think 4 was the UK and 5 was Mexico, if I'm not mistaken. But that type of idea, like, okay, it's vastly different. Or even stuff like Need for Speeds. Each one, story-wise, is very different. Well, now they're very different, and they're trying to do different things. So that is why what I consider to be like, okay, this is not DLC, it's a whole new game. Whereas with DLC, it's kind of adding to what the original story was. It's like more content based on what was already shown.
Yeah.
So you can take stuff like Fallout DLCs for Fallout 4. It's like you have Fallout 4, the base game, and then each one is just kind of adding to that base game in some way, shape, or form. It's like, okay, let's add some story content for this chapter or that chapter, you know?
Oh, or even stuff like First Light. I gotta jump to that, because Brian, that is such a great point. Like, to me, like, it feels like DLC if it's like an add-on to the story. Like, it may not work on its own. Like, it could work on its own, but it's like you get the fuller picture once you take it into context of where it originally came from. But yeah, it does feel like, hey, here's a slice of the main game, and let's, or like an offshoot. So yeah, you basically said what I was trying to say before. Yeah, that's perfect. Yeah.
Yeah, other stuff like First Light, like that perfect example of DLC. It's like, it's literally giving you the story of another character that was in the main game. Like, it can stand on its own in that, okay, you can play it without having played the thing it adds on to, but you get way more value if you know that.
Yes.
And also, you kind of get like the weird inverse, where if a game feels like it's being padded and stretched out and doesn't seem to end properly, then you get the issue I have with God of War, where it's kind of like they kind of just didn't fill in the space with content, but they kind of stretched it out. And then you now have God of War or Dad of War 2, where it's like, okay, this is now a weird, almost part two to part one. And it kind of, and it slightly irritates me. Now, I can say this is the exact same issue that I had with the original God of War 2 to God of War 3, where God of War 2, like, it literally ends before you fight Zeus. And then God of War 3 is just you padded out until you fight Zeus. So it's kind of like you could have made this all into one game if you really wanted to, but they decided to stretch it out into two games. And again, as much as I love God of War 3, that's one of the biggest issues I have with it. It's like this, 3 didn't need to happen as such. You could have ended it with God of War 2, you fight Zeus, game of story, you know, or end of story, you know, but they didn't. So that's how I tend to class things, as whether or not it's a sequel or it's DLC. And again, my favorite DLC is Big Surf Island for Burnout Paradise. It's literally just it's an island that they added on to the map.
That was good. Yeah, that was good.
You know, great example of DLC.
Yeah.
So, Brian, would you consider God of War 3 a DLC then?
God of War 3 is something that shouldn't have happened. In that they could have finished the story in God of War 2 easily, but they decided to, for some odd reason, I don't know why, put it as something else. And it irritates me that they did that, but I still enjoy the product, if that makes sense.
So it's a DLC that you enjoyed?
You could argue with that. And then this actually brought up the idea that I had, in that there are DLCs that have turned into full games. For example, Phoenix Immortal Rising or something.
Immortal Rising, yeah.
That started out as a DLC for Assassin's Creed. Assassin's Creed. Which one was the one in not Egypt, in Greece?
Odyssey.
Yeah. It started off as a DLC for that, and then it just came its own full game. So there's been examples of DLCs that started off of that and then went into full games, and it's interesting.
Yeah. Manny, what do you consider DLC?
DLC.
What's your criteria? Like, what makes a game DLC versus a full on, you know, its own game?
How much of the original game it's using? I would say Miles Morales is most definitely a DLC than an actual full game. Even though, despite they sold it as a full game, it's literally the same aspects, most of the same game, except with some additional things to it and some story things.
Yeah, also a smaller version of the main game.
And it's a smaller version of the same of the game. The other one I would say was definitely First Light is a DLC, even though that was another one of those games that was literally, sold as its, the DLC was sold as its own title.
Yeah.
Which it really wasn't its own. It really isn't its own standalone title at all.
Yeah.
Full game like experiences, like as far as like sequels.
I think you already answered the main question. What do you consider a DLC versus a main game?
Yeah. Those things are both, I feel, DLCs. The opposite side, I would have to say, is the Uncharted thing. What was it? The one with the two.
Lost Legacy.
Lost Legacy. I would say, I would consider that a new game, just for the plain fact that it's not using any of the environments of any of the previous game. It still has a lot of aspects of those things, but it's all new stuff. So I could consider that a totally new game, even though it is considered a DLC at the same time.
No, it's its own game, too.
It's its own game. Okay.
Yeah.
I would have considered... Okay, so tell me this. Why was Far Cry Primal its own game, but Far Cry Blood Dragon a DLC?
Because Far Cry Primal was a fuller game.
It used the same map. Reused the whole map.
Oh, yeah. Like how they just converted it to Primal Times. No, yeah. But again, I'm just speaking for myself. It's a full game versus Blood Dragon, where it's just 5 hours and you're done.
I mean, yeah, I guess.
So,
but that shit still gave you new levels, new system. It just baffles me.
But the thing is, with Blood Dragon Primal, you wouldn't have known it's the same map unless you read about it. I didn't know. I played the whole thing. I had no idea until I read about it on the internet. I'm like, oh, that's interesting.
You mean Primal?
Yeah, Primal. Yeah, I had absolutely no idea.
Yeah, because they arted the game enough to where it literally looked like something else. Yeah.
And then when I read that, I'm like, oh, that's actually kind of clever. This is the same map, but a million years ago. That's kind of cool, But yeah, I had no idea. But yeah, again, that game took me 50 hours. It was a full story beginning to end and all that. So it felt like its own thing. By the way, Primal was fucking awesome. By the way, that was the first game I got accused of being paid off because I gave it a good score. Because all the other game journalists were giving it kind of mass scores, and I gave it a fucking high score, right? And then I was vindicated because that game sold 10 million copies, So fuck those people that say I got paid off, Anyway, Chris, DLC, what do you consider DLC?
Well, I mean, for me, it's just a short experience or a side story that reuses most of the game it's based on. Spider-Man City That Never Sleeps, it's the same map. Yeah. And they introduce one more character, but it's a side story. It's like you follow Black Cat and you do all that stuff, but a lot of the stuff is the same. You have the same map, you have the same abilities, maybe you get a couple of extra, I don't know, I forgot. Mm-hmm. There was some extra suits, and but that's it, you know. So it's like, that's not a whole game. Like if they did a Miles Morales with that shit, I would be pissed too. I would be like, what the hell, it's the same shit, you know, except it's a side story. And then they have Resident Evil 4 is going to have DLC. They're going to add in the, you know, the separate ways thing, so you play the game from the perspective of Ada Wong, but it's the same map, it's just from her perspective. So she's off doing her spy shit while Leon's running around trying to save Ashley Graham and all that, and you see it from her perspective, but still the same story. It's happening at the same time. That's not a new game, right? That's the same thing. If you're talking like you have built on top of like a story and you've added serious mechanics and then a whole new experience and a substantial amount of story, that to me is enough to account for, like, okay, that's a separate game. It's like when they did Majora's Mask after Ocarina of Time, it's like there was enough there. It's like, yes, this is essentially Ocarina of Time, but you have a whole new map, you're in a whole new place, a whole new game mechanic with the time travel, and that you control, and then, you know, you're preventing the moon from crashing the earth. Okay, all this stuff and all these characters, even though they're analogs to the old characters, they were different enough. So it's like, this can count, right, as a new game. So they've done, Nintendo has run into this once before with Ocarina and Majora's Mask. The same thing is happening now with Breath of the Wild and Tears of the Kingdom. The only difference was the time difference. I think Majora's Mask released a year later, and this is like, well, we're at 6 years later. So that's the only difference. But yeah, that's what I consider DLC. So I would say, like, with the example with Tears of the Kingdom, there's enough there that I think, not having played it yet, but I think that justifies it being its own game. I'm not saying justify $70. I think that's bullshit. But being its own game, yes.
And Chris is not saying justify $20 either.
No, yeah. No, I'm not saying it's a $20. It should just be a $60 game for Breath of the Wild.
I honestly think one of the big reasons this game is getting this is, like, man, it did have the development time of an entirely brand new game, and then you come up serving, you know, leftover casserole. Like, don't get me wrong, that shit's delicious sometimes, and it can be a really good game, but, like, y'all had the time and the budget to develop some new stuff. I guess, again, there wasn't a lot of reason for it if you don't have new hardware, but I think a big reaction people are getting is kind of like, so this is what you get after 6 years, 5 years, whatever it is.
You mean the people that are naysayers? Because most people are like, oh my god, this is the greatest thing ever.
Yeah, well, like, because I don't think, like, granted, this uses the same map, and by all intents and purposes, like, I should say it feels like a DLC, because this feels like the closest analogy I can make to it is, ironically, Link to the Past, when you had two of the same world, just different. So it's the same land, but it's different. But it is pretty expansive, and they added a new layer on top of it, and I think that the whole them doing it's the same place but different, I feel like that's intentional. I don't think that's necessarily lazy. I feel like that was probably an artistic decision. So it feels lazy. It may look a little lazy, but I don't think it's intended to be that way. And I think it genuinely is big and new, but you can't help but a little bit whenever you hear, like, really, 5 years? This is 5 years worth of work? Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Blitz says, Tears of the Kingdom is two times the size of the original map. It uses pieces of the old map, but it's different.
So two times the old size, as in the original map that's edited and then a new map? Or it is now a total of three times the size? Because, yeah, it better be twice the size if it's reusing half of it.
Okay. All right. Moving on here. Oh, not a question from Tumeka. Another one. Right. With the next Mortal Kombat rumored to be a remake of Mortal Kombat 1, or at least a reboot for the franchise, what do you hope to see? For example, trimmed down the roster, returnable fatalities, next-gen graphics, etc. My thing is, didn't they already reboot Mortal Kombat, like, two Mortal Kombats ago?
Yeah, like Mortal Kombat 10. Yeah. Didn't they do that?
Yeah, like I remember they went back in time. Like they went back in time and reset everything. So are we doing this again? Is that what's happening?
Or is it following that? Is like they altered time, so now we're in this new...
Wait a minute. There's a cohesive storyline through the Mortal Kombats?
No, they tried to cobble it together into something cohesive, like saying there was like alternate dimensions and timelines, and I don't know, Liu Kang gets some god powers and goes back in time.
That is some bullshit multiverse stuff, right? That is.
Yeah, see, Brett, there you go. There you go. Thank you.
That is using, no, I'll admit when it happens, that is using the multiverse for evil right there.
There you go. That's my problem with the multiverse. The multiverse itself is not the problem. It's the way these fucking hack writers use it, you know?
Oh, my God. This is like, I don't know, other reality or something. Like, what do you mean, or something? Did you actually write "or something" on the back of the box?
Probably.
Why?
Or something.
Yeah. Logic wins. Thank you, sorry.
Somehow.
Somehow.
Somehow that happened.
Oh, man. There was something literally like a TV show or something that said somehow this happened. Like, what do you mean somehow?
What? What? Like, you're writing it. Yeah,
I imagine. Like, it's not my job. It's your job.
Yeah.
It's like when a writer leaves a story open-ended. They're like, and then they wandered off into the field, and the sentence ends halfway, and they're like, oh, maybe it was this one, or maybe it was that one. Fuck you, you're the writer. You just didn't finish your job.
You know? Logic Win says it's another reset. Okay. But you're like, that's stupid.
I mean, to a certain extent, I don't know if I'm going to upset people with this. It's a fighting game. Who cares?
The Mortal Kombat community does. And remember,
And
by the way, just to be fair, the last two Mortal Kombat games have been the biggest selling games from Warner Brothers. So, and that's why I'm confused. I'm like, okay, the last two games sold like gangbusters. Why do we need to normally you get a reset when the shit ain't working no more, the sales are dipping. Like, the last Mortal Kombat game itself sold a lot. You know, it's the best-selling fighting game, one of the best-selling games of the year, period. So why are we resetting? It doesn't make any sense to me, you know?
Maybe they think they can make... I mean, you have to constantly... I mean, either have to be completely iconic or reinvent yourself fairly regularly in that genre, I feel like. Like, you have to... I think they're just trying to stay fresh, probably.
Yeah, but you see what I'm saying, where I'm like, the last game was the best-selling Mortal Kombat of all time. Like, what? You know?
Yeah, but that's using logic, Tony.
Yeah, you're right. Okay, so the last one was Mortal Kombat 11, because the new one is going to be 12. It makes no sense to me. But yeah,
plus, it's going
to
be Mortal Kombat Budokai.
Oh, God. Yeah, I don't care. I used to love me some Mortal Kombat, you know?
So let me ask this. Is the current the last rebooted Mortal Kombat in gaming tournaments?
The current one is the one that's out. 11 is in tournaments. Yeah,
11. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, but okay. Yeah. It is. Yeah. Oh, it sold 15 million copies. That's a lot. You know.
Well, I just didn't know if it was still in tournaments because So it sounds like this reboot wouldn't be about changing any format to be better tournament play.
Yeah, because, you know, and again, this is what Mortal Kombat did that was genius, that he had, like, okay, if you're just a casual guy or you just want to go through a story, we got you covered. If you're a FGC guy, we got you covered too, you know? So yeah, it's still in tournaments. People are still liking it, you know? So it was already FGC friendly, if that's what you're getting at, you know?
Yeah, I guess I was. Well, maybe they're just keeping it fresh, man.
Yeah.
Like, we bitch about Assassin's Creed going stale. Maybe they're just trying to keep ahead of it.
Yeah.
And maybe it's not, like, a complete reboot. Maybe they just want to do some core adjustment mechanics, maybe change a couple moves, change out the roster. Fuck, I mean, worst case scenario, this could just be to cut back the roster so that they could sell it to you piece by piece again.
But. Yeah, right. I mean, they already were doing that. And, yeah, just to confirm, the Mortal Kombat 11, the latest one, the best-selling game of the franchise. So
it seems a weird time to. I mean, maybe they're not going to change much, though. Maybe they're just going to refine it a little bit more, and they want to do a story reboot for some reason.
Yeah, I mean, but it also, now I'm thinking about it, it also weirdly makes sense because, like, fighting games right now are, like, more popular than they've ever been. So I guess it makes sense in that way. But
I can understand releasing a new Mortal Kombat.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
The thing that
it's
I'm a little
reboot. It's the reboot.
Weird. Yeah, like,
yeah, I don't get that.
When reboot, does that mean you're going to change it? Or this is just kind of a story reboot? Because, like, yeah, like that, I wouldn't mess with that formula now, man. Especially if it's wildly successful, it's got good reception, it's being played in tournaments. Like,
that's why I'm confused. Again, literally, Mortal Kombat 10, the one that did the reboot, they did that so you could have the original Johnny Cage versus the new Johnny Cage. Like, you already have all the rosters of every Mortal Kombat ever released. What do you need to reset for? You have every character at your disposal already. Every version.
Well, then that means they don't have any characters to sell you.
I guess. I don't know. It's weird. Fergus, what's going on, brother? All right. He goes to chime in on the Mortal Kombat. A slight spoiler: Liu Kang went back in time to do something. This game should not be a reboot like that, but should take place in the past. I mean, I guess. Again, I'm just weird out because the game it's the best-selling Mortal Kombat. What's the reason to reset?
Maybe it's not a reset. Maybe saying it's just a story reboot because I didn't really catch the story in the last one. Did it have a pretty clear end?
In the story mode, it did. I mean, it had an end for that story they were telling, but obviously there was still more you could tell. You know. And it was actually a pretty good storyline. Like, I played through it because I reviewed the game. The game was good. But it's one of those things, Brett. It's like, you know, you finished off the story, but there's still more that could be told, you know?
Well, I mean, if it's just going back in time and changing things, that's, to call it a reboot would be like calling every single Terminator movie a reboot.
Yeah, but again, they've already gone back in time and rebooted it, so I don't know how they're going to reboot this time.
Again, every Terminator goes back in time to undo the movie before it.
Yeah, so maybe they're going to undo the previous. That is stupid. All right.
Yeah, and that's the problem when they do bullshit time travel. Although I will admit that I kind of love the concept that they failed so terribly at with the Terminator of, yeah, each movie should almost be the first one to chronologically take place because they keep like leapfrogging each other back into the past to fuck things up even more.
So
Terminator 4 should be happening and make Terminator 2 never happen.
That happened. That already did happen.
But it's because Terminator 2 happened that Terminator 4 did. Yeah. Retrocausality is, in fact, a thing. Yo.
Yeah. Fucking hacks. All right. And the last question of the night, Villa Kyle. This one is interesting. I just shrank it down to its biggest thing, but he was here. He basically was hearing a Joe Rogan podcast. Michio Kaku was on talking about quantum computing, how powerful it is. Anyway, with near infinite computing power, what impact do you imagine quantum computing will have on the video game industry?
Have I talked about AI yet today?
No, you haven't. So go ahead.
I mean, obviously, you get like if we can get that close with AI and large language models now, you could get really horrifyingly realistic with your next GTA, man. Like, you could have a hooker tell you her hopes and dreams before you beat her to death for the cash in her pocket. Just, I don't know, man. Like, I've been watching a lot of how games are affecting AI, or AI is affecting games, and I think a big part of it is going to be, it's going to make games cheaper. It's going to replace a lot of fucking people, and games are going to be able to be made with a lot smaller studio.
They're not going to get any cheaper.
Hey, baby, thank you.
Cheaper to make. Yeah. Cheaper for them. Their profits are going to rise.
Oh, well, we're going to pay more.
Yeah. That sounds about right. They'll pay less to make them, and we'll pay more to buy them. Yeah, it sounds right.
Mm-hmm. But, I'm up there.
Yeah, but they'll turn like a 60-person team into a 20-person team, and you know the horrible thing will be like, It won't benefit the artists at all just because like they'll have quadruple the workload. You'd think like, oh, if AI helps them, it could make their workday a little shorter, could make their week a little easier, could make it a little easier to hit performance. No, they're just gonna fire three other people and then make one person do it. Mm-hmm. So I think that you'll be able to see things. I think we have a problem now of kind of a critical mass of talent. You know, it's by the time you get enough bodies thrown on a problem that you have the talent needed to solve it, it's a large enough group of people that really pinpointing that talent and raising them up becomes kind of difficult. So I think that I don't want to say that like people who are bad at their job are going to be the first ones to be replaced, but it's definitely going to help some of the cream rise to the top. And I think people will be able to do things more better with independently. But the biggest one is, I mean, it's right in our face. Like the language models, just the idea of like, oh, I had a dialogue option with a character and I had four choices that I could say to them. And it made it sound like it was going to affect something, but never did. When we tell somebody that in 20 years, they're gonna be like, why don't you just like talk to the character? They're like, talk to him. Like, oh, we couldn't do that. We just had to pay. It was like a multiple. All conversations were multiple choice questions. I think it'll just be weird when you're able to just straight up, you know, talk to your character or have 9 billion, you know, things that come up that are kind of generated from your past experience.
I also think it's going to change a lot of the development too. I think like with something like Unreal Editor, where you can have this kind of node-based programming, where it's like C++ underneath, but you have these nodes where you can pull in properties, and so you can visually see how characters interact and whatever. So you pull in quantum computing and AI into this. It's going to be even simpler. Like Tony was joking out, somehow this happens.
Yeah.
You will let the AI model you have figure it out, right? Like, okay, so we have this big map, and I want this city in this industrial area, and I want some kind of like third-person shooter mafia type game. You start putting in all these like prompts, like what. You know how like ChatGPT whatever works now, and then it's gonna spit out all this stuff, and then it's like forget about needing to sit in a 3D program, making your map, carefully sculpting maps and all this stuff. It will start generating all this stuff. It's like, I need this building here, and it's 70 stories tall and has this and this and it, and it's gonna be, you know, the rival gang's territory. You have to climb up the building and, you know, to get this thing, and it'll just do it. Like so it's going to change how the games are developed, but it's also changed the experience, because now with the games, we're sort of at the point now where it's like, man, these maps are huge, right? It'll get even bigger, and then you'll have like the AI generating the maps, right? So it can even keep them consistent. But it will, it's like you go, well, I wonder what's out there. Like you, Brett, you always say, I want to climb that mountain out there. Well, not only would it be to climb that mountain, it'd be like, oh, I wonder what's on that continent. So I'm just going to hop and boat, like, go over there, encounter everything along the way, all the islands, stop at 12 different islands. It's just like, well, I've been playing this game for 15 years. I still haven't reached the mountain on that continent I was going for. You know, it's just going to, the scope of games might just approach a point where it's like, well, but, you know, I don't need anything else. I'm just going to play whatever, you know, GTA 7 or what the next iteration of Elder Scrolls that leverages that thing.
I can't wait to see videos like player builds a ladder all the way to moon. You won't believe it, with a red circle in the thumbnail.
Yeah.
I can definitely see where Chris is coming from, but I think that's more of a just like a worst case scenario, which I'm certain some company will be doing, because companies always just reach for the weirdest and weird and worst things. I can see Ubisoft doing that, because that seemed like a Ubisoft thing to do. How I consider things in terms of AI being used in games, I can see it more or less being used for stuff that's mundane. So, you know how we always say, oh, it'd be nice if we can, like, play GTA and, like, walk into every single house and just explore. I can see them, rather than paying, like, environmental artists, however many, to model every single house so that's slightly different. You can just say, okay, have an AI that will do each house and assign, like, a different style to it. So one is modern, one is postmodern, one is whatever, you know? So I can see it being used for stuff that's so mundane that you just don't want a person to do it, because they'll kill themselves because it's boring. So hence it's like, okay, make AI flourish this house so that person can walk into it and take stuff. Fine. So that's how I would like AI to be used. But I can see that the way that things will be used is Chris's example, where it's just like, hey, let's just build endless nonsense.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, no. I mean, that's, I like what Brian says, and that's been a dream of mine. Like, you know, totally destructible environments to be able to go into any house, or it's like, hey, what's in this building? What's in that building? I love that. But I feel like companies are like, just throw more content, and then the map is endless maps and endless interactions and all this stuff, and it's like, it's just too much. You know, that's where I think they'll approach the technology.
Yeah. All right. Let's start wrapping up. Good show. Good show. Good show. Do we have anything to plug?
Yeah. The first episode of the last season of Fear of the Walking Dead came out today. I still haven't seen it yet. I'm going to watch it tomorrow morning or tomorrow during lunchtime. But expect I Am Negan to come back tomorrow night on your feeds on thecoalition.com or the Coalition YouTube channel. I don't remember if it's on the Coalition proper or the Coalition Gaming channel, but one of those. Just make sure to check your feed for I Am Negan and on all the podcasting sites, and you'll be able to catch up the show and see where the fear is going to be ending up.
The nuke. All right, man. Good stuff. So make sure you follow Throwdown on Twitch and Twitter. Join a Discord where the conversations and the rumors are always popping. You can find us on any podcast app by searching for Throwdown Show. That's two words. Throwdown Show. Throwdownshow.com to listen to past episodes. And if you've been watching us on YouTube and enjoyed the content, make sure you hit like, subscribe, and hit the bell to be notified of when our premieres go live. Links to everything down below. Once again, I was your host, Tony Polanco, and tonight I was joined by Emilio Lopez.
He went to the bathroom.
He went to the bathroom. All right, Chris Seeley.
Hey, take care, everyone.
Carlos Romero.
Peace out.
Brett Murdoch.
Peace.
And Brian Manjoma.
If you vote for the people that promote face-eating vultures, don't be surprised when you get face-eating vultures.
Oh, boy. Oh, man. All right, people. We'll see you on Thursday. Later.
Ladies.